Mr. Pereira, Mr. Pandya, Dr. Verma, colleagues from Spiga, students, and I see at least one faculty member here. I'm very glad that Mr. Abdullah and Spiga together have organized this workshop, because if one thing that South Asia needs is research and presentation of research. And I'm also very happy that so many people have registered for it. It's another matter that we seem to be maintaining a South Asia standard time. 10:30 can mean anything. I have, or maybe it's an Asian standard time, I'm not quite sure, it's really China. Because when I lived in Indonesia, 10:30 could mean almost anything. It could mean 11, it could mean 11:30, it could mean 12, it could mean not showing up. And since I taught in the University of Indonesia, and when I told some Indonesian students this, they told me that here, time is flexible. So, we have rubber time. What they called it was, it's a rubber time. But I hope in South Asian University we will start maintaining not rubber time, but actual time. But in any case, I'm happy to see all of you here, and I'm sure this workshop will prove extremely useful in writing methodology, techniques, standardization of the way we cite, the way we punctuate, and all those good things. And it will also give access to and a knowledge of the international journals in which we can publish. It will also tell us something about the impact factor of the different journals. And all these are very, very important for a university. I hesitate to say a research-based university, because all universities really should be research-based. However, this certainly is meant to be a research-based university. With these few words, I don't want to stand in between you and your workshop. Welcome once again, and thank you.
Only Springer. So it's a bigger brand, a stronger brand, and I'm glad that I'm here today, and thank you very much Mr. Modabar for organizing this workshop, and I would also like to thank Dr. Sharma for being here, and also the vice presidents of the university. Thank you so much. And all the students, and I hope this is going to be an interactive workshop. If you have any questions, please feel free to come up with your questions. We'll be happy to answer. And we have done these kind of workshops earlier also. Professor Sharma, who's the resource person, is also very experienced. She comes with a background of about 3 years of conducting these workshops. She has done about 50 odd workshops in totality. So she is a very, very experienced resource person. So please be interactive. Talk, speak up your mind, and take the most of it. Thank you.
So, Parth, so probably you can come around and take the floor on.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you to South Asian University for inviting us, esteemed professors, students. Just for me to be able to understand my audience, if you could put your hands up if you've published in a journal. Have any of you published in a journal? Is that an Indian journal or an international journal? Sorry?
International.
International, okay. Anybody published a chapter in a book? Okay. So I would request that question and answer will be right at the very end of the session, because I think as we go through, a lot of things will become a little bit more clearer. I have a little habit of walking around while I'm talking. I hope you're okay with that. This workshop I've been conducting for the last 3 years in various places, including IIT Delhi, FMS, XIMB, CIS, and whatever. I draw on my experiences as the... I was earlier in publishing. Just a little bit about me. I was earlier working for Sage Publications, so I have the publisher's perspective. And now that I'm into academics, hopefully I have the scholarship perspective. And since I'm, the PhD journey has been a fairly new thing for me, so I will also be sharing my mistakes that I have made as a doctoral scholar, which hopefully will be useful for you, and hopefully you won't make the same mistakes. So some of the slides are self-evident, some of them are just read-only kind of slides, others I will go through. And this is how we're going to divide the presentation into 6 sections. After section 3, you'll be distributed an editing exercise, and it'll just take 10 to 15 minutes, and then we'll resume the PPT session. And as Surabhi, my colleague, has said, that we want this to be interactive, so I'll be throwing out questions and hopefully you'll respond. Okay? You can hear me in the back? Okay. So, let's talk about why do we need to publish. Publishing, like anything else, is all about preparation. Say you're in a cricket team or you're playing some sports, you need to understand your own team, your skills of every member, you need to understand the competitor, you need to know the rules of the game. So very similarly, as a researcher, you need to understand the game. You need to understand the publishing game, and that's what this workshop is about. Okay, so the question that I want to throw out to the audience is that why do we need to publish? I mean, you're all here today, so I would assume you want to publish. Why do we need to publish in a journal or in a book? Anybody? I'm not getting. You want to publish so that.
I want to publish a particular thing that we have researched on, so that no other people, I mean, do the same thing again.
But the original work.
Yeah, original work in the sense that unless it has already been done, so what's the point of doing same thing again?
Okay.
So one of the things.
Okay, that's fine. Anything else? Why do we need to publish? What is the reason? Why do we need to publish? Anybody in the back?
Circulation of knowledge.
Okay, to add to epistemology, to add to knowledge, absolutely. Anything else? There's lots of reasons.
Sorry?
As a scholar, it will add to your credibility as a scholar. Is that what you're saying? Okay, very good. Your research can be a springboard for other research, like in every journal section you have now. Future areas or future directions for research. So very good. So I think you basically answered the next slide. We need to publish to add to epistemology, credibility as a scholar, credibility of your university, don't forget, that goes up. Facilitates networking, you meet some incredible scholars working in the same area around the world. My concern is with this. I do this workshop, this is my motivation, because whenever I go to the Academy of Management conference in America, which happens once a year, out of 10,000 management professors who are invited from all over the world, and I'm in a couple of executive committees, there are only usually 113 Indians. So apart from physics and chemistry, in which we do very well in terms of publishing as scholars in India, in many other subjects, we're terribly far behind. Okay? So that's my motivation. Of course, course, why publish in English? I mean, one can have a lot of debate upon this, but it is the lingua franca when academic writing is concerned and you have to prove yourself. If you're not very strong in English, it's really not a big problem. It's more important for you to package your writing in a particular academic style, which is what this workshop is about. If you're weak in English, your final manuscript can be given to a copy editor who can clean it up with a some meager payment. So that's not really a very, very major problem. But your copy editor will not be able to put your structure of your paper and citation references in place, which is what you need to know as a scholar, right? So does anybody, I mean, since largely none of you have published, you may not be familiar with the process, so I'll just go through this in a bit of detail. You might have heard of peer review. Does anybody know what is a double-blind peer review? Anybody in the audience? You published, sir? Okay. What is a double-blind peer review?
That means the researcher from the same experience, they will review the paper.
Okay. So when your paper is sent to a journal, two or three professors will look at it independently and they will review your paper and give you comments. Okay, that I'm not sure you would have heard of a peer review, right? But a lot of people don't realize before that there is another stage, which is called the desk review. Okay, anybody heard of a desk review? Now I have asked, I'm on some editorial boards internationally, and I have spoken to very, very leading professors, editorial board members, and I've asked them that on what grounds is a paper desk rejected. Okay, the very first person to see your paper will be a desk reviewer. She will only look at your title, your abstract, your keywords, and the reference section. She will not read your paper, usually. And based upon these four facets, she will come to a decision as to whether to send it back to you as a reject or whether to pass it on for the peer review process. That's how important writing is, packaging. Okay? Your whole paper, which could be 1 year's effort or 2 years' work, and somebody's just going to see the title, the abstract, keywords, and references. Now, the title and the abstract and keywords tells the desk reviewer about originality. Is it original work? Why do you think she wants to look at the reference section? You understand a reference section at the end of a journal? Why would the desk reviewer want to have a look at the reference section without looking at the paper? What sense does that make? Guys, you gotta think out of the box.
To see if you kind of research well in the literature and you know what are the research gathered.
Excellent, excellent. What's your name?
Surabhi.
Very good, Surabhi. Excellent. To make sure, number one, that you've quoted the extant literature. Do you understand extant literature? If there's some term you're not understanding, then just, you know, on our own. So, for example, I published a paper on sense-making and sense-giving, and if I had not quoted Carl Wake, who is the person who came up with the sense-making concept, then that means I have not done my research properly, and I could be rejected at that very stage, okay? Second reason is to see your writing style, to see that have you actually put in references in a proper manner, whatever the style may be, APA or MLA or Harvard style or whatever it is. They look at that also. And if you haven't, that becomes an irritant to the peer reviewer. So are we clear? You first have a desk reviewer who will reject there and then, or accept and then pass it on to the peer reviewer. They do their peer review. After that, there's a few things that can happen to your paper. It can be rejected immediately, sent back to you, sorry. Very often, sorry, this does not fit our journal. Not sorry that it's bad research, okay? Or secondly, you could get what is called an R&R. Scholars often talk about R&R, which is a revise and resubmit, in which you'll be given some indicators as to how to improve your paper, and then you resubmit it, and then again it goes through a peer review. And then in the end, if say, let's say you get through all these hurdles, then you face what was my team in SAGE, the editorial team. And there again, if your citations and references and stuff are not in place, then you'll face a lot of queries from the editorial team. So that's why it's very good to keep everything clean right from the beginning. Okay?
How can you select a good journal?
We'll take questions in the end if you don't mind. So Jesus healed the man, but we're not sure about getting published, huh? So, oops, I think I explained that basically. The editor goes through a peer review, and eventually, if you're very lucky, after an hour and a half, then it can be accepted as a publication. How long does it take? This is a question I often face. You know, it's variable. It depends on the journal. It depends on how well you've written or not written. Yeah, if you've written a shorty manuscript, it's going to take longer for it to get published. It depends on how many peer reviewers the journal has. Very often we get stuck there as journal editors. We don't have enough peer reviewers. How many revisions? You know, I know a gentleman, a scholar, well-known scholar. Academy of Management Journal is one of the top-ranking journals in my field in management. He was given one R&R. He was very happy that he got an R&R from Academy of Management Journal. It's a big thing. He revised it, sent it back again, got another R&R, revised it, sent it back again, and got rejected. You know, that's how long the process can be. And this took several years, by the way. So this is very common. If you look at the pie chart, it's very common that you will get, it's very likely that you'll get an R&R. So don't take this as a personal affront. I mean, I've spoken to a lot of young doctoral scholars and young faculty who the minute they get a revise and resubmit, they take it as a personal attack. And some of them have said, I'm never going to publish after this. And yeah, I mean, nobody's personally attacking you, right? I mean, if you get an R&R, it's actually, I would say, compliment. It means it's been through the desk reviewer. She has seen something original, some spark in your work, okay? Only then it's gone to a peer reviewer. A peer review means that 2 to 3 faculty have taken out their precious time on an unpaid basis to look at your work and to point you in the right direction, to say, okay, fine, you've got a reasonable piece of work, but we would give you these indicators, X, Y, Z, as to how you can improve further so that possibly you can get published. Some of the language of the peer reviewers may not be very congenial. They'll send you missiles. But the intention is to get you published, right? And they're spending, as I said, unpaid time. You know, and it takes a long time to review a paper. When I review a paper, I go through it at least 3 times. It takes up a lot of time and energy, yeah? So do not take R&R as a negative thing, it's a positive thing. So we're going on to section 2. Read, read, and read. As doctoral scholars, you should really be reading 3 papers every day. Whether it's in your area, aligned area, not in your area, doesn't matter. But it should be like brushing your teeth. You should be doing this on a daily basis. And believe me, the more you read, the more you'll start understanding how good articles are written. It starts getting imbibed, you know, in you. So please read, and possibly if you can read the top journals in your field, of course that helps, the A grade and the B grade. Try not to go down to D grade, you know. So it helps you. I mean, you need the reading to help you get writing properly. In the reading, you can look at things, what do scholars do? How do they explain, for example, a hypothesis that has not worked out, an unexplained finding, or you know, something they were not expecting in the research and that's happened. How do the authors explain that? Because you might have that scenario in your research, okay? So look at these trends. Also go to as many conferences as you can, because it's a wonderful opportunity to network, to share your ideas, to get feedback about your own paper also. And if you see the very top journals, very often at the bottom of the paper it will be written that this was earlier presented in version 1 was presented in so-and-so conference. People go to conferences to get feedback from the audience of scholars that, okay, you know, you could have improved it on this, so this is a future area of research and all that kind of thing. And then they incorporate it and then it goes on for a good publication. This is what journal editors are looking for. Something original and novel, high quality research, interesting to the journal readership, and of course good English. So original and novel should be your research. Original and novel should not be the way you do your writing. So if, for example, you are told in a journal style guide that please submit your manuscript in Times New Roman 12 points, double spacing, then do not give it in, you know, some other font, 9 points and in single spacing. There do not be original. Are we clear? Because reviewers are very used to reading papers in a certain format, and it's important that you give them that required format. I mentioned earlier that one of the biggest reasons for a paper rejection is that it doesn't actually fit into the journal. It's very important, you know, in HR you are taught about a person job fit. Yeah, person job fit is the best way. You get a satisfied employee and a good work performance and whatever. In research, it's very important that you have a paper journal fit. So for example, if I have written a qualitative piece of research, and I'm sending it to a journal which has largely quantitative studies, of course I'm going to be rejected. Yeah? Doesn't matter how well I've written it. There are journals which are multidisciplinary. So again, you have to be careful. You have to do, you know, law and political science, not just law, for example, right? So you have to be very careful. So how do you get the fit? Even on this, you have to spend a few days. You get the fit by reading what is called aims and scope. Is anybody familiar with this term? If you look at a journal, if you say you have a hard copy journal, it's usually in the front page, the front cover, inner front cover. Sales journals especially, you'll get about one paragraph. And online, of course, you can see. You'll get one paragraph which talks about the aims and scope. So for example, in Sage, we were dealing with 8 management journals, including Vikalpa and MDI's Vision and Accelerize MLS, and we're dealing with all these journals and management, but they all have different angles, even within that same umbrella. Okay, so you need to see which is the best fit, the appropriate fit for your paper, and believe me, that's half the battle won. The mistake I made as a scholar was to wait until I'd finished my first piece of research, which took about a year or so, and then I started looking for a journal, and I think that was a big mistake. You know, one needs to start searching your journal from day one. The very day you conceptualize your piece of research, you think, okay, I want to do a study on this. That is the day you start looking at journals online. You may be able to shortlist 5 or 6, and the best way to shortlist is to go into the keyword section of the journal. So for example, if I go back to my paper on sense making, the journals that I was aiming at, I put it into the keyword search and I found that yes, there are some papers on this area. So that makes it more chances for you to get published. If you show that you are continuing what we call the chatter, you know, you're continuing the conversation on that topic, it is obviously better to cite a few of those papers also from that particular journal. That enhances your chances of getting published there. So are you understanding about what I'm saying about your paper journal fit? It's very imperative, right? Because every journal has a target audience. It's not just, you know, your institution has started a journal just for their name and that kind of thing. They have a particular target audience. Like it could be a theoretical journal, so it's based only for scholars. There are some journals which are based for practitioners and scholars. Yeah, there are some which are largely practitioner-led. I mean, few of them are like that, right? Some are purely conceptual, some are purely quanti. So they all have an audience. So you as the reader have to think, what is the journal's audience? What is the aims and scope? And is my paper appropriate for this? Not give me that my friend told me you're going to get published in this journal, or my professor told me. You know, not through hearsay. You have to do your own research about this. Okay? So you need to see, is your manuscript consistent with the journal's mission and editorial statements? Is it in agreement with the qualitative or quantitative bias? have there been similar papers like that in the past, and how many times, you know, you have to cite that journal also in your manuscript, okay? These things are looked at when you're being reviewed. Does anybody know what is open access publishing? Anybody familiar with open access, Yuva?
It is available without subscription.
Available without subscription. The current model of publishing is who pays? Who pays for the journal? You're a research scholar, you send your paper, it gets published. Who buys it at the other end?
Consumer.
Who's the consumer?
Researchers.
The institution. Institutional subscriptions usually take on journals, right? It's the institution that pays, and then you as a scholar, you have access, you're given a password or whatever, and then you can see it. The open access publishing started off from an American university where the taxpayers had funded the research of that particular university, and then the taxpayers asked that, you know, if we want to actually access a paper, then why do we have to pay for it? Because we've already paid for the research, so it should be open access, it should be available to everybody. And it became a kind of a movement where some leading scholars were saying information dissemination should be open for all. So for example, if there's a scholar in an African university that doesn't have much funds and the library is very, you know, sparse, it's of a disadvantage to that scholar, right? Because our research starts with a literature review, is it not? So open access has started, it's out there, but one needs to be a little bit careful. You can, there are some good open access publishing and there's some not so good. There are some which say that you pay us and we'll publish whatever you write, which I wouldn't go into that, because then if they publish anything, then, you know, it's not good for your reputation. But there are some publishers who've also got into open access publishing, like Sage, they have a separate division and that kind of thing, which goes through a peer review. But in this, the scholar pays. In this model, it is the scholar who pays the open access publisher to get published. And then it's all open access to everybody. Everybody all over the world will see your journal. So there's some studies going on about open access publishing at the moment, but they're not very conclusive. But some scholars say that perhaps there are chances of you getting cited more because it's open access. Others say that no, possibly not. You're not going to get cited because people tend to see this as a low quality journal. So it's not very conclusive at the moment, but you should be aware about what it is. I'll be leaving these slides here. So if you get time, this is a very interesting video about, you know, it explains in a cartoon form exactly what is open access publishing. Okay, Springer has got some wonderful things for authors. You know, like if you go onto the author website, it will tell you about the journal. Any journal that you put in, it will tell you basic information, impact factor, how often it's published, a lot of which will help you in choosing your journal. Remember I was telling you about the fit, journal fit? So, keywords are very important. Why do you think journals ask for keywords? Online searchability. So if they say give us 5 keywords, please, you as the author have to do that. I mean, the words that come across most often. Try not to repeat the words that which are in your title, because then that's a repetition of the online search. Abstract, be very careful. Again, if they say we want an abstract in 150 words, then please give them that. Emerald, in which I published, they asked for an abstract which was divided into 4 different subheadings. You know, introduction, then main results, and implications, and whatever, whatever. Again, you have to fit into that. I mean, it took me 3 days just to write the abstract, which is actually the most important part of your paper, I would argue, because that is the window to your paper. That is the window to the peer reviewers, the desk editor, and it is the window to the person searching online as to whether they're actually going to read your article further, purchase it or not purchase it, or read it even. Yeah? Or cite it hopefully one day. So abstract is really important. If a journal says, you know, we want you to write in American or British English, again be careful. Follow the guidelines. American English, it would be better, since we're not so much used to it, to give it to an editor to clean up, because Although we do know certain things like favor doesn't have a U and a program doesn't have an ME, but there are some nuances that you may not be aware of. For example, percent is one word in American English, or there is the serial comma usage. Does anybody know what is a serial comma? Like if you have a list, cat, comma, dog, and cat, in British English we don't put a comma before the and, but in American English there is a serial comma before the and. So, you know, if you're not aware about these things, it's better to write your paper, give it to an editor, so they can put it into the American English usage. Your use of quotations is usually a single quote we use, and a quotation within a quotation is double quotes. Be sure to end your quotation somewhere. This is a problem we used to face in the editorial department. You know, very often authors would begin a quotation with a six, but they would not end it anywhere. So then how does the editor know where does the quotation end and where does the next sentence begin, right? Try not to use quotations as an emphasis. You want to emphasize a word. Better to make it bold, because if you use quotations, it gets confusing with a citation, okay? And double quotes I've explained. Double spaces. Spellings, it's very important to be consistent. So for example, there are some words in which you can get two versions. Let's take the word Shiva. Shiva can be spelled as S-I-V-A, diacritical mark, or S-H-I-V-A. They're both correct. But if you take both versions in your paper, then there's something wrong. You have to stick to one version. Okay? Consistency is the key. So again, use of italics and diacritical marks, please be consistent with that. And give full form of acronyms. Do not assume that your audience knows your acronyms. So for example, I've written a paper on business schools in India, why there's not enough research coming from the top 10 business schools in India. And I got a query from the peer reviewer saying, what is IIM? So we assume, we're in India. So when you come up with any short for any word, like let's say World Health Organization, write it out in full, then write in brackets the acronym WHO, and subsequently you can use the acronym throughout. Okay, but first time write it out in full, don't assume that your reader necessarily knows. Tables and figures, any table you take from any journal or book has to have a source at the bottom of it saying where have you cited this from. If you do not, then that's plagiarism. Others will be taken as your table. If you come up with a table, like say for example SPSS, then you have to put at the bottom table by author or computed by author, something like that, to make it absolutely clear that whose table it is. They need to be numbered, and there needs to be what is called an in-text reference for tables. So a table should not just appear all of a sudden in your work. You should first refer to it. That, you know, in the next table, number so and so, I will be saying blah 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 with this data, and then the table appears. Okay? And it's best not to take a table just to pad out your journal paper. I mean, there must be a purpose for you taking somebody else's table. And also, again, be careful in the sense that if there are three columns you've taken, you've cited from somewhere, and you've added a fourth column, even that has to be mentioned in brackets, that the first three columns are cited from Smith, 2010. The fourth column has been constructed by the author. You have to be very, very clear about your sources, about tables and diagrams and figures.
Yeah.
You have to cite it. You have to cite it. Secondary source. You're talking about a secondary source.
I have exam paper.
Okay.
For some things. They put it someone's case.
Original, the original. You have to go to the original. Gray and Smith 2000 or whatever. The first table. Who has constructed the first table? Okay. And secondary sources are really not recommended, you know? Because if you keep, do you understand secondary quotations? If I have read Gray and Smith in Sharma's book, okay? And I'm saying Sharma said Gray and Smith said this. It's really not recommended, because if you have a lot of secondary citations, then the peer reviewer is going to think that aapne to mehnat kiya nahi, you've not gone to the original source. They will not understand that perhaps it's the third world country, you may not have access to that source. if your American scholars or whatever scholars sitting out there, they will not get that, right? They'll just think you're a lazy scholar. So it's really good to avoid secondary sources if possible. And secondly, you know, your lens may be different. I have gone back to primary sources myself, and I have disagreed with the person who's come up with whatever they've come up with, because they're looking at that work through a different lens, perhaps, right? So it's always important to go to the primary.
But ma'am, sometimes we go through a review paper and we get something, and the original resource, if you try to find, and it has been longly worked, if it is worked on 1820, and you are able to get that paper.
No, that's okay. If it's a very old archival thing, you're not able to get access, then it's okay. You can use secondary sources, but I'm saying don't use too many. So if in a paper you have 100 citations, 2 or 3 can be secondary sources. But if you have 80 secondary sources, then me as a peer reviewer, I think you're a very lazy scholar. And I would doubt your credibility. Then why have you not gone to the primary sources and come up with your own interpretations, right? That's the point I'm making. These are all copyrighted material, people. If you take a table, chart, figure, map from somebody else's work, not only do you have to write the source, you have to get permission. Very often the permission lies with the journal, or the permission may lie with the author. So you have to write to the journal, and usually they'll just send you an email saying, oh, fine, we give you permission. But without this, the publishers often will not let you print. They will not print your material unless they have all the permissions in place. Okay? You've got to be careful. Springer has a very nice tool which helps you select your journal also. So basically, you just insert your proposed abstract. You copy-paste your abstract over here, and it will come up with a list of journals where it recommends. It doesn't mean you'll get published in them. This is just an advisory, okay? And it will tell you that which is it matching the best. So this is a tool that will save you a lot of time, if you can have a look at that. And it will help you make a decision. Okay, publication ethics. If you send your journal, if you send your paper to one journal and they're taking a long time for reviewing, should you send it to another one also? Why? Why not? You can save your time, right? Send it to two. Correct. But it's actually totally unethical. It is totally unethical in scholarship that you cannot send your paper to multiple journals just because you want to save your time. And you can get caught also. What happens is very often, and it has happened, that both the journals have sent the paper to the same reviewer. And then he has written back, and then you are blacklisted from both those journals. They will never publish anything of yours again. So it is unethical, right? So please stick to your one journal. I mean, I had one paper which after 1 year of research, then 1 year of R&R, then after that it was 2 years in the print queue. So it took 4 years for that particular paper to see the light of day. But you know, it's not possible for me to withdraw it at any stage. Okay? Yes.
If somebody else does that with research and publishes it, who is to be blamed in that case? Like somebody submitted a paper 3 years ago, but then finally got rejected, and meantime somebody else started the research, got it published. So who is to be blamed in that
That's
case?
That's hard luck.
but
happens. It's happened even in thesis, never mind paper, you know, like one of my strategy professors was coming up with a very novel idea, and he spent rather a long time on it. By the time he got his thesis out, he defended and everything, but his concept 6 months earlier was a slight modification, but it was taken by an American scholar who, that scholar is now getting cited everywhere, so he missed the boat. I mean, that's just tough luck. But there's a silver lining, I mean, in the sense that there are a lot of doctoral scholars who are very resilient, and they don't give up. So there's a very beautiful book I would recommend called Wendy Belcher. It's How to Write Your Journal Manuscript in 16 Weeks. It's a Sage UK book, I think, UK or US. Beautiful book. She writes not just how to write your journal, but what I liked about it, she was recounting the experiences of her doctoral students throughout the book. And one of them, you know, he got so many rejections. He was rejected 16, 17 times by various journals. You know, like he sent it to one, three times, R&R rejected, then he sent it to another. But he believed in his research so much that he kept revising it, and eventually he got published in a very highly ranked journal. So, you know, being rejected, it's part of the game. It's part of the game of publishing. You will be rejected. We all have been. But then you have to just improve yourself, and as you've understood, you have to also come out first. You know, it's a race out there. So, for example, my area of research is negative mentoring. Say 5 years ago, this was a virgin territory, but now in the last 5 years, there's been so many publications. It's quite incredible.
And about peer reviewers, is there a confidential agreement or something, like if I send my paper to publication and then you peer reviewed and then I have consecutively 3 R&Rs and you might communicate the idea to somebody else, he might start doing
research. No.
There
is trust out there in the scholarship world. Nobody will reveal your paper. I mean, I've never come across it. It may be happening, but I've never come across something like that. And the 3 peer reviewers also don't interact with each other, by the way. It's a blind review, no? It's totally blind. So I have received reviews from 3 reviewers which are actually contradictory. You know, I read the first one is saying, wow, immediate publication, fantastic. The second one says, okay, fine, thorough literature review, you have to strengthen it. And the third one says, rubbish, and we're not going to publish it. And I was like, my God, now what do I do? You can even get 3 totally contradictory ones, you know? So in that kind of case, I wrote to the journal editor and I said, what do I do? Because I don't know how to respond to this R&R. So she said that you respond, whatever you agree with or disagree with, and I'll take the final call. So she took the final call and it was published. So they're not even meant to communicate with each other, the professors.
I have a question.
Yeah.
And reviewers are basically from the same thing, are working on the similar subjects. And one of the reviewers picks up the idea because he's already working in the same area. And he decides to take inputs from that paper and he publishes his paper on the basis of that paper.
That's what she was saying.
It
was terribly unethical. But I have personally never come across it. I know a lot of scholars out there. I mean, have you come across something like this?
But
we have come across something like that.
How ethical this publishing
is. Very unethical. That example is extremely unethical.
You have a legal remedy for that. Don't need to be worried. You have a legal remedy for that. Copyright subsists the day you have written your work.
Exactly.
So it's not that the point is that whether the work is published or not through some legal like that.
But I thought there was no law for copyright.
No. There is a law. I mean, the day you have written your work or poem, whatever it is,
right. It is yours.
And
but the Da Vinci Code case, he lost the case. No? The original author of Da Vinci Code, the original author whose story it was, he lost the case. Because, you know, the court said that there's no copyright of ideas.
Unlike patents, where you have to go and register for your work.
Correct.
In copyright, you don't have to go before your office to register your work, or you don't have to go before a publisher to publish your work. The day you have written, copyright subsists with you. So you have to go for a legal remedy rather than discussing
it. But, you know, let's just take this as a hypothetical case. Say I've written a piece of work, I send it for peer review, it's my original piece of work, I send it for peer review, they reject it, 1 year later, I see somebody else publishes something very identical in the same journal. Right, I can then write to the journal author, the journal editor, and then I'll show you in the next slides. If you are caught doing anything unethical, then you are put onto this website. Your name is put on a website that everybody can see, and you're totally blacklisted. So, I mean, I really doubt that they shouldn't do it, but you know, there are ways around it. I'll show you that slide. So, I don't know whether you remember this case, if you can just read the slide. This came in all the papers.
Yeah.
So these two IIT Kanpur scholars, and it was all over the papers. I mean, it was not just humiliating for them and IIT, but also for India, of course. They had taken things even from Wikipedia and not cited. They had taken chunks of material from elsewhere and not cited. Now, in this Google era, it is very easy to copy paste. You go into Google Scholar, you'll find a PDF and a paragraph, yahan se le lo, wahan se le lo. But it's also very easy to find plagiarism. I used to teach my editors, you don't even need these tools, Turnitin. There are several software programs where you can catch plagiarism. It's so easy, like if one of my editors is editing a piece, she starts understanding the style of the author. For example, some authors miss out the article, T. They put the article in the wrong place. You know? And if she comes across a paragraph which is very excellently written, where the article is in the right place, then she'll immediately get suspicious, and I would tell her, you take that paragraph, copy-paste it, put it into Google, press enter, and it would be a plagiarized paragraph. We would find it so easily. So don't go there. Don't go into plagiarism. You know, everything has to be cited. If something is not your idea, it is not your idea. You have to cite it. Cite it and then criticize it, or say, I disagree with this, or I feel there's a gap, or I feel this is not sufficient. That's your prerogative. But the work has to be cited, even your own work. There is something called self-plagiarism. So if I have published a paper in 2009, and then I published a similar paper in 2011, and I've not cited my original one, that is called self-plagiarism. Even that is not ethical. That is wrong. I have to treat my own work as if it is an independent scholar's work. Are we clear? So this is the website, Retraction Watch. If you're found doing anything unethical, plagiarizing and whatever, then your name goes up on here. And then no journal will publish you. The consequences are pretty huge. And there is a written document about how one should be ethical in the scholarship field. So there are, this slide is from my experiences in the heading and editorial department. We used to find, as I told you, at times the authors, suddenly one paragraph appears too perfect. Another way of plagiarism, we used to find that some authors would just mention sparse citations. So for example, you know, one paragraph they may write at the bottom, Duck 1994, so it's cited. And then the subsequent paragraphs, there's no citation. So the reader is thinking that that's the author's work, but that is also Duck 1994. So you have to cite everything that is not yours, okay? That is also plagiarism. You can't just cite once and then not cite again. Okay, so how do we actually do the writing of a manuscript? I'm not talking about your subject areas. You're the experts in that. Your professors are the experts in that. I'm talking about the way of writing, the beginning, the middle, and the end. And after this section, we'll take a little break, and we will have some editing exercises distributed to you, which will take 10 to 15 minutes. I find that if people actually do editing exercises, then it kind of sticks for a long time, yeah? So you have a beginning, a middle, and an end, and it's cyclical. Your end has to obviously correlate with your beginning. Are you familiar with the IMRAD model? IMRAD means introduction, method, result, discussion. And this is basic to most fields, whether it's social science, most fields follow the IMRAD. Just read this for a minute. This is why you need to write well. We all do this, right? We skim through. I mean, how many of us actually read a paper from beginning to end, right? So that's why you need to write well. There has to be flowingness, you know, from your one paragraph has to flow into the other. People have to understand what you're saying. And I got this from a paper which was reviewed. AJM again is a very leading academy journal. If you just read this. So this leading reviewer seems to be implying that the first impression is the last impression for a reviewer. That if you write in the proper reference citation style and your Times New Roman and double space with the IMRAD structure, then that helps. I mean, it helps a lot. Yeah? It's best to follow this methods and results right while you're doing your research. Introduction, discussion, after selecting your journal. You know, because then you can tailor make your paper for that particular journal. The more you, let's say I'm targeting one specific journal and I keep looking at the papers of that journal, how do they write their introduction, how do they write their conclusion, and I write in a similar style, then my paper will be a better fit in that journal. And it's best to write your title and abstract last. I mean, I don't know how many times I rework my title and abstract. You know, it could be 20 times, 30 times. I keep reworking it until I feel there's some sense of perfection. And I never think they're perfect, but you have to keep reworking because, as I said, that's the most important part of your paper, your title and your abstract. And make sure your abstract actually captures the cream of what your paper is saying. Not added information here and there. It has to say what your paper is saying. What was the gap you found? What was the results? And what are the implications, basically? Title, it's best not to... I mean, I kind of fallen into this trap where as a scholar, you try and find a really pretty title, you know, like a pun on words or something like that. We read it all the time. Huh? Top scholars, they write some incredible titles which are really hard-hitting. But it's better, I have found, to write a boring but accurate title which actually says what your paper is trying to say. Then I had a pretty title once, but then I abandoned it because it was saying 95% of what I was trying to say. It's more important to have a slightly boring title with the correct words, because again, online searchability is a big thing. Yeah. No abbreviations in your titles, please. So we've spoken about how important the abstract is. Critically important. This is a very rough estimation. Depending on what, I mean, they may specifically say that we want 150 words or 300 words for an abstract. But if a journal doesn't say, then this is how you should look at it. And in an abstract, don't include things like references, abbreviation, jargon, and non-essential numbers and statistics. That just all has to go inside your paper. So going back to the beginning, middle, and end. Introduction, the beginning. You need to think of a pivot.
A pivot?
Upside down pivot, in which you start by talking about what is the literature out there, what are scholars saying in this field, but in a few paragraphs using what is called string citations. Do you understand string citations? Like say I'm talking about mentoring and I'm talking about positive outcome variables, scholars have said this, and in antecedents they've said that, and in correlates they've said that. So in each of these, I put citations with five or six authors that are all together, string citations. So that shows I know my literature, I know that area. So you don't have to put a literature review in your introduction, okay? But you need to show in a few paragraphs that you know the area using string citations, saying that this is largely what the scholars have said, and then you go deeper. But I feel there is a gap over here, and then deeper. And this is what my research is about. Then you get right into your research, and these are my research questions. Okay. In the middle, you explain the rationale for your study in more detail. Again, we're in the introduction, middle of the introduction. What is the rationale? Why? It's very important to have you ever heard of the so what? The so what of research? Has anybody heard of that term? So what? You know, very often as a as a reviewer, I have rejected papers because it could be a good empirical study, and this is a problem I find of scholars in the South Asian region especially. There could be a good empirical study, you've got your MRAP, you've got everything written in the right place, you've got your title, abstract, keywords, everything is fine. But I'm left with that question as a reviewer that, so what? What was the point of this research? What are the implications? Very often scholars are not able to draw, and you need to start drawing that out from the beginning. From the introduction only, you should start saying that my research is important because of X, Y, and Z. Yeah? So be very careful about that. And then you have to add to that in your conclusion section. So the peer reviewer must be left with the feeling that, okay, they should not be left with the feeling of, so what? What is the point of this? It's almost as if a professor and a student have had a corridor conversation and the professor says, "Iska kar lo research." You know, I mean, that's the impression I end up with as a reviewer. Like, what is the point? Point kya? So at the end of the introduction, you clearly state the specific aims and state the methods you're going to use and talk a little bit about the citations. Then we get to the middle. Middle is largely about your methods. Which methodology have you used and why have you used that compared to others? Then you have your results. Results have to be written in a factual format. Here you do not put in editorial comments. You will say that these are my statistical findings, these are my results. You will not put in, you know, I feel this and I feel that. Okay? Label all parts of your figures. Here are some examples. So you've got a legend, a caption explaining what the table is about. Clearly label axes. Again, one problem we used to find in the editorial is that very often authors will talk about some data in a table in the text, and the data in the text does not actually match the data in the table. So again, you have to be careful what you're writing. Make sure it matches. Discussion section. This is very difficult. Try not to overstate the importance of your results. It's always best to say that our findings suggest. Because if you say our findings prove, tomorrow somebody may disprove whatever you said. Yeah? So what are your results compared with others? So if I'm doing a study on, I did a study on Indian women entrepreneurs. So I first looked at all the literature which was largely from the West and came up with pull and push factors. And then we did a qualitative study in India. And in the conclusion, I looked at the pull and push factors we found and compared it to what the literature was. And we found a couple of new things. So that is your research. Okay? Compare it with other results, other literature. And please always describe limitations. Nobody's paper is perfect and you're expected to provide limitations. If you don't, you're going to be asked by the reviewer to provide. What were the limitations? Was your sample too small perhaps? Or do you feel your sample was in a high power distance equation, it may not be as relevant to low power distance equations or something like that. Come up with some limitations. You're familiar with Mendeley and EndNote. These are all tools to help you as a scholar, which we never had at our age. Google Scholar, do you know how to cite from Google Scholar? Again, it's very easy. You just go into a citation wake, go into citations, and you can go into one of these, or you can just simply copy paste, right? RibTech is a good one. But be careful when you copy paste, because there are some errors also, by the way. These are not perfect. your Google Scholar, you know, there are sometimes there are commas and brackets in the wrong place.
Citation, if we are using the software related to site by that,
we're distributing sheets now, so you can work in pairs. I'll give you 15 minutes. You can work with two people at the same time, or you can work individually. It's up to you. Okay. I won't look at your work, so don't worry. But after this, we'll discuss it. I'll put up some slides and we'll discuss it. And it's both sides of the sheet, one side and one side. So 10, 15 minutes you have, editing exercise, both sides of the sheet. It'll be better if you work in pairs. If you want to work singularly, it's fine. So if you just look at the screen, please. Number one, there's this unedited excerpt, which you have to edit. Then there are some incomplete references. I'm not asking you to put, please listen to the instruction carefully. I'm not asking you to edit this and put it in MLA and comma full stop. I'm not asking you. I'm asking you, what are the missing elements? Do you find any missing elements? Are you clear about that? Journal reference or book reference, what are the missing elements? Okay? So we're not talking about editing this, we're talking about finding missing parts. This is a self-explanatory, two questions, and then this is false, true, false questions. Okay? So please start, you've got 15 minutes. You can work in pairs, two, you can work if you want. So then you know what are the gaps in your knowledge, and you know, so it's basically for you. But the most important thing I want to stress upon you through this editing exercise is that the importance of references. Now, why do you think we have a reference section in the first place? Why at the end of a journal paper do we have a reference section where all your citations are put into full form? So the work can
traced.
So the work can be traced. Very good. So that anybody reading can go to the primary source. That's what you're saying also. Any other reason? Of course, to show that you've cited the extant literature. But the if you keep that fundamentally in your mind when you're writing a paper, that how can the other researcher trace a particular piece of work? Okay, so that's very important. So let's go through the editing exercise, look at what you've written. Were you able to catch all of this, number one? And there are still some mistakes in this slide. Let's see if anybody's got an eagle eye out there. There are still some mistakes which have not been corrected. You're familiar with track changes? This is incorrect with track changes. Can anybody point it out? One by one, guys. Yeah, tell me. Anything else? No, English and philosophy will not be in capitals as per APA. APA says academic subjects are not put into capitals. As per APA style. There are different styles. Okay, something else? You remember I was talking about consistency. There's something inconsistent which has not been corrected on this slide. Have a look.
The committee must be capitalized.
No, it's actually the article. This should be here. This inverted comma should be here.
Greenhouse.
D is the article, it's not the name of the committee.
Greenhouse is that?
Greenhouse, very good. Who said that? Eagle Eye, find a topic I told you. What have we found, Greenhouse?
Once you have a hyphen, another.
Exactly. Look at the inconsistency. Here it's hyphenated, here it's one word. It is actually one word. So this is a big error, is it not? It's a big error of the author. And this is a very easy English language thing that we're taking. But you understand where we're coming, like sunlight, why is this capitalized, huh? It's not a proper noun. You remember when in name, place, animal thing, when we were taught as kids, huh? You don't just capitalize whatever you feel like it, it has to be a proper noun. Okay, so IBIT, what is IBIT? What is IBIT? Very good, excellent. Citing the same source as was previously cited. So if I write in, just one second, if I write in one page, Smith 2009, and in the next paragraph again I want to write Smith 2009, I will write IBIT. You were saying? Very good, excellent. On the same page. Why? It has to be a localized reference. Do you think it is recommended? Is IBID used recommended? Why? You're correct, it's not recommended, but why? Publishers don't recommend IBID. It is the old-fashioned way of, you know, repeating a citation. You'll find it in old papers more. Do you have a reason?
No, I have another question.
Okay, sorry. It is not recommended by publishers because, as this gentleman said, it has to be a localized reference on the same page. So what happens is you submit your document in either Word or LaTeX, but by the time it gets converted into a different format, it could be PDF or whatever the publisher wants, then it could shift. Things could shift. So your IBIT may go onto another page, which then makes it not very relevant. So try and avoid using IBIT, but you should know what is IBIT. Yeah.
I think IBIT is about citing this immediate source, you know. It's not about the same page. So for example, if I have what...
No, it's both. It's immediate source plus localized on the same page.
I think for that we have off-site. Off-site means for the same page or probably the same work which has been cited above.
Okay.
So even for the same immediate previous.
But it's, like I said, it's not really opposite. Even there are old-fashioned ways of using things. Maybe you're right. I'll have to look it up. Maybe you're right.
So like Google titles are always thing. Then like if you are moving on to the next page, then you have to make photographs. Then you have to give reference to the page. And if, like for the same source if you are writing on the same page, then it would come on the same page. And you mentioned like in the recent like the citation would shift in another format.
Correct. Absolutely right. Good. Some of you are with it. Okay, and what is a bibliography? Reference in where? In what? And rubber? No, not article.
Book.
What? Bibliography is only in a book. Guys, we need to get this clear. Very good. Yeah, I don't think you need to be in this workshop, you know, no. So, I hope nobody's heard you, because I'm going to ask, what is the difference between references in a journal at the end and a bibliography at the end of a book? Please be quick. What is the difference between references at the end of a journal and a bibliography at the end of a book? Cheating. Anybody? Why do we use the word bibliography? Well, it must be something different, right, to references? So, in a journal reference section, you have to, every citation has to have a reference and every reference has to have a citation. If you have cited somebody's work, you have to have a corresponding reference. Are we clear about that? There is no extra reading that you put into a reference section, and that is what you have in a bibliography. Bibliography is extra reading that you've done in that area. In journal scholarship, it is expected that you would have done a lot of reading. So if I use 70 citations in my one paper, I would have read 350 papers plus books. That's expected. So you do not put in all those in your reference section. They'll all be cut out. Because as I said, every citation and every reference has to be matched. Only if you cite somebody, then it goes in your reference section. Please be clear about this, because audiences really have a lot of confusion about this. Bibliography in a book is things you have cited plus added work that you have read, or work that you recommend also that should be read. It can go that far. Clear? Okay, so you know what is bibliography and you know what is IBID. Okay, the missing references part, can you open the section where you, any missing items that you found, anything missing? So in this one is what? Is this a journal or a book? Why is it a journal? Because it's a volume number. What is the volume number? If it says 47, what does that tell you of the journal? How many years has it been alive? 47 years.
Of 30
years. That's your issue number. That's what's missing, right? There's no issue number. If it's at 47.3, that means third issue of the 47th year. Are we clear? So this is very essential information. In a journal, you must cite the reference, the issue, and the page number. Absolutely essential information for anybody to be able to trace that paper again. Remember, the importance of references is that somebody else has to go back to your primary source. You must have volume number, issue number, page range. Okay? If you don't, then it's going to be looked as shoddy academic writing. You know, you may not get even into the peer review stage. And even if you reach right to the end, everything is accepted, you get to the editorial department, they're going to send you a list of 100 queries, which would totally delay the, you know, print of your piece of work. Second one, it's an occasional paper, but it's not clear. Okay, what institute? Occasional paper is like a white paper, but how will you trace this? No? Is it from South Asian University? Is it from JNU? Is it from California? We don't know, no? So how do you trace it? So that's a missing element. Number three, is this a book or a journal? Book. Is it an edited book or an authored book?
Edited book.
Why do you say it's an edited book?
It is in that particular.
So this chapter is in this. But why are we using et al? Do you understand the meaning of et al? There's more than one author, but in an edited book you have to write all the names of the editors. Cannot be et al. Okay? And then the page range also, the chapter that you are citing, you need the page range for that in an edited book, almost like a journal. This one, what is missing? Publisher's name. In a book, you need the publisher's name, Sage, OUB, Springer, you need the name, right? And place of publication, absolutely. And the last one, again, this confusion. Is this a report published by the American Council? I mean, where do we trace it? We're not sure if this is the publisher. A little bit of confusion. So do you understand the importance of references? When you write references, always think of the reader. How is the reader going to access this primary source? Have I got all my pieces of information correctly there? Okay? This one, check what you have written and compare it to the slide. You can tick off your own whatever you've written, compare it to the slide. Why is this one important? Date of access of a website? Updated. If I access something from a website today, are you going to have absolutely. Removed, updated. Absolutely. So if I access a URL website article today, I mean, one should not put too many URLs in an academic paper, but let's just say you take one. I would have to write at the end of it, accessed on so-and-so date, today's date, okay? Because somebody tracing it, and then in a newspaper article, it's very important to mention the edition also, Times of India, Nagpur edition. Okay, that's very important.
Madam, yeah. If we are referring to a journal, why we are not required to write the name of the publisher? Like if we are referring to Indian Journal of International Law, so are we not supposed to write the publisher also, Springer?
Why people write it in their resumes, but you don't need it in the reference. It's not required in the reference. It's the name of the journal which is actually cited fully. I can't answer why. I don't know why, but that's
probably I can answer.
Yeah, yeah, please.
Because sometimes what happens, like some of the journals are not directly published by a particular publisher. We have tied up with various societies for that purpose. So the particular journal, maybe today it is being published by Springer, and tomorrow we'll sell the copyright to some other publisher. So this keeps on happening with the publishing world. So probably that's the name of the journal is important rather than the publisher. Because a society which is, you know, publishing through Springer today, they may decide to discontinue services with Springer and they will start publishing with some other publisher.
But that work is always going to remain with that publisher.
No, that's what he's saying.
Sometimes there is a contract, sometimes the editor of that publisher, the journal, they think of a better publisher than the existing publisher.
That's a very valid answer. That's a good answer. But references is the name of the journal which is taken. But I've seen in a lot of people's resumes, you know, like people who are applying for professor jobs, they'll add in the name of Emerald Springer, whatever, just in there, to show it's an international, you know. Excuse me, can we have the previous PPT where we set up? Okay, so this was an exercise for you, just to understand things a little bit better. Okay, section 4 now. Cover letters. Why are cover letters important? Especially from Springer journals. Cover letters are important because so many people are applying to that particular journal, right? There's so many people sending in their papers. The cover letter shows that you've chosen, selected that particular journal. You're going to write, this is my original work, I've not sent it anywhere else. Just a few lines here and there to show that you're really interested in this particular journal. And it helps. So these are the things you need to include in the cover letter. Not all journals allow you to write a cover letter. I mean, you would need a hyperlink or something, but I know a lot of Springer journals do. So you'd mention it's original, unpublished, not submitted anywhere else. If you have a source of funding, no conflict of interest, these are the things that you'd be writing in that, yeah? You can always write to the, you know, as doctors, scholars, one piece of very fundamental advice I'll give to you, which I knew in hindsight. You know, you're in a rush as doctoral scholars to publish. How many papers do you have to publish before the end of your journey? Two in A-grade journals. Is there any other category? In any journal? Okay, oh, that's easy. So you're in a rush to publish, right? Because publishing processes are totally can take years, okay? So if you get stuck with a journal like what I did, which took 4 years for it to finally see the light of day, you know, you really get stuck. I have a friend of mine at XLRI, and she's done everything. She's at the thesis defense stage, and she's one paper short, and her professors have said, we're not going to let you go into your final defense. So luckily, I know a journal, we managed to get a paper quickly, but what I'm saying is that it can be a real problem in your journey. You know, you have to start publishing now. Don't wait for final year or whatever. You know, start the process now, wherever you're at, first year, second year, whatever. You know, you have to, you can very easily write to the, there's nothing stopping you writing to the chief editor of a journal. Let's say you have finally shortlisted a couple of journals, maybe three journals, let's say. Write to them and say that, you know, I have this publication and I think it's a really good fit and I would really think it's good for your audience, blah, blah, blah. Please can you let me know that after R&R process and after final submission, first of all ask them how many months does it take for the peer review process, then ask them after, in case it is finally accepted, you know, how long will it take, how long will it be in the print pipeline. Ask them these questions, you know, if you have a, it makes a difference, so it will help you actually shortlist better. Say you have three journals, one says we do 3 months peer review, another one says we take 9 months for the peer review. You know, already your time is ticking, so you may decide to go for journal one, right? And another one says after print, you know, we keep it in the pipeline for 2 years, 3 years, and you'll be in trouble as a doctoral scholar. So there's nothing stopping you from writing to chief editors and they do reply. Some of them are very organized and have all this written in their actual, if you go to their website, they have it very, very clearly written how long they'll take in their process. They're very organized journals. So you may at times, this is more for a book actually, you know, if you're writing a book, the publisher could ask you, can you suggest some reviewers? So if you need to suggest some reviewers, make sure they're not very, very high-end reviewers. Aim for the maybe mid-level researcher, because the high-end reviewers are too busy and they'll never get around to reviewing your work, believe me, you know, they're just too busy all the time. And if you are asked to be a reviewer, these are the things you need to look at. How good is the piece of work? What are the findings? What are the limitations? Are the conclusions supported? Is the literature cited appropriate? You can even suggest to the person as a reviewer that I think you missed out on reading X, Y, and Z, which I do once in a while. Are there contradictions within the manuscript? So if you get an R&R, the person may have written to you in a very not nice manner, in a rude manner. At times you get such professors, but you need to reply very politely, okay? That goes without saying. And please do your R&R in a manner which makes it very easy for the person. You know, again, we have to go through somebody's work. Like I said, I read somebody's paper 3 times, then come up with my comments. It takes a lot of time and energy, and then after that I'm given to see the resubmission, and they do it in a manner where I have to keep going back to, okay, what did I say, what was my comment, what was that, have they done it, and I have to check it. You know, it's very difficult. One of the best I found was where somebody, and a scholar, she had included all my comments in a table format on Word on the left hand side, and then actually pasted paragraphs on the right hand side addressing my comment. You know, like I said, you need to change this or change that, and then she pasted something on those. So at a glance I could see that has she answered my query, or has she done what I've asked her to do. And then at the same time after that table, what she did was copy paste the whole manuscript below that and color in yellow the particular places where she'd made changes. Again, I could go through the whole manuscript just at a glance and just see very, very quickly. So please think of the reviewer. You know, it's tough for us guys. It's really tough. You know, it takes a lot of time. So do your R&R in a format, and I'm just giving you one example, there are many ways of formatting, but do it in a reader user friendly format, okay? Minimize, there's lots of tools now to help you minimize your language errors. So this is the checklist, the things you need to look at, which we've been talking about. Again, I'll just go through very quickly some tools. I won't spend too much time on that because you can look it up. There is a real-time Springer, this is a lovely tool. We get 3 downloads every second about people's research happening, right? So if you look at this, you can look at exactly all the latest stuff that's happening around the world in your area. You can filter it out for your particular area, specific journals also. And so it also tells you not just which are most cited, but which are the most downloaded articles. A lot of people may read articles, but they may not cite them also. No? So that statistic is also important. There's a lot of manuscript guidelines, a lot of very useful things for your authors. If you look this up, springer.com/authors. LaTeX also. This is very interesting. If you put the name over here of your town, it will tell you how many authors are in the same area. You can put in a search that say I'm doing research on mentoring. I might actually discover somebody else doing research on mentoring in the same city. You may not even be aware about it. Or you can put in a search of South Asian University and see which scholars are doing what research. Or any university. This is a very useful tool that you can find. Author mapper. So Gwalior tells me that there are 3,522. This is Springer authors, right? And out of 1,417 institutions, and they have 377 publications between them. Okay? So do look these up. Very useful. Again, you can put in a scientific term or phrase and then it will tell you papers in that area, which will help you do your literature review better, quicker. And you can store your own papers over here for your personal library. Which one?
Papers.
This one?
No,
the
Springer
product. Okay.
No more
Springer. Okay, I'll delete this slide. This is not here. What happens when you publish with Springer? Very often you get cited. It's difficult to get published in Springer, get through the peer reviews. There's some good Springer books also about, you can take this further, how to write scientifically. Springer books, many, many different type of books are there. Monographs, contributed volumes, proceeding textbooks. You get Springer briefs, which are much smaller books. The advantage of this is that you have a very quick turnaround. If it's accepted, you know, it can be published very, very quickly. The problem with books is they have a very long span of them to get produced, no? By which time your data and everything might get old. So this Springer Briefs is a good way to get out publications quickly. Okay, somebody in the audience was talking about they're doing their dissertation, they wanted to get published. So how to convert, you know, 95% of theses are rejected by publishers as books. You know, one often thinks that, oh my God, we spent 5 years and so much effort and of course it will get published and people send it and it gets rejected. Why so? Because it is such a specialized document. Your thesis is going to be read by you, your external, your thesis advisory committee, and possibly nobody else. Let's face it. So, you know, it's so specialized. So to convert it into a book, you actually have to rewrite the whole thing. You have to redo it because you have a wider audience, right? Your audience is not going to understand your statistical analysis and your big jargons that we tend to use, you know? So a lot of the stuff one could put in the appendix, for example, one would have to redo the literature review, one would every chapter would have to flow into the other, almost like a story. You might have to come up with fresh data because by the time you started your research, it's like 5 years on, right? 5 years ahead. So one has to completely redo. So don't have this impression that thesis ho gaya, I'll send it to a publisher, it'll get published. Okay, it doesn't happen that way. Cut down on footnotes, endnotes, cut down on methodology. That's it. We'll take question answers. I think there's quite a few questions floating around.
Can you submit an article in the journal?
That's my problem.
When we submit an article into a journal, why is that always the article date? The review date always keeps shifting. Let's say we submit in January, then after 3 months or 4 months, it will show the date of the next month, like March. Okay. After 3 months, then show the date of the June, and then so on. So the question which came earlier, like why people used to, you know, other people submit the same article and they will get published. So don't you think this is a part of the journal?
The inside answer is that the biggest problem with journals is the peer reviews. It's very difficult to get hold of professors who will spend time, hours, free of cost, reviewing somebody's paper. It's very difficult, you know. So I'm telling you as an industry, an insider's point of view, because I've worked with 68 societies producing all their journals. They face a problem with peer reviewers, and in fact I would highly recommend that you also reach out and become peer reviewers. Reach out to journals, tell them I'm a doctoral scholar, I would like to review some. It's a wonderful learning, it's one of the best ways of learning to become a peer reviewer. And in the end, if it's a good journal, they will then share with you the peer reviewers of the peer reviews of the other two or one, which will help you also build up your standard. But the answer to your question is, this is a fundamental problem in the journal industry. It's not only you as a student who's suffering, it's the publishers who suffer. We can never keep up with our timetable and schedules, our deadlines, you know, because of peer reviewer nahi hua, the journal late ho gaya. It's a problem, it's an endemic problem.
So it means that reviewers keep changing after 3 months or 4 months?
No, they don't change. They don't do the reviews, sir.
So,
like, say for example, I have a review right now with me, a Journal of Organizational Behavior 3.14 Impact Factor. I've been given 1 month. I've already overshot by 1 week. I mean, I'll do it within, I will stop all my other work and do it. I don't want to delay it by more than 1 week. But that's very rare. A professor may be given 2 months, he'll take 6 months. So what will the publisher do, no? Then they just keep deferring the date.
We can change the reviewer.
And then get another professor who again takes 9 months.
Reviewers are basically, they are not paid anything for reviewing any article. It's a, basically their interest lies in, you know, once you become a reviewer, it becomes easy for you to publish a paper in the same journal later on. Because as a reviewer, you have a higher chances of being published. And secondly, the whatever, you know, contents you see or read, go through the whole bunch of papers, ultimately you are enriching your knowledge. So that is basically for your own sake. So it's a free service, so you can't force anybody to read it within 2 weeks or 3 weeks or 4 weeks, and especially those areas where there are very few reviewers of that subject. Because you cannot send a physics paper to a chemistry professor, obviously a person who is working on nanomaterials, you have to send that paper to the person who is working on nanomaterials only, especially on, let's say, there is another subject of some tubes, carbon nanotubes. Now if somebody is working on carbon nanotubes, you can send it to only that person only, and there will be very few reviewers across the world. So it's not that, and they are also busy persons, they are basically into research, they can't spare time to read those. So that is up to them and they want to read it. In case, yes, there is a delay and we feel that there is no reply from these reviewers for, let's say, 1 6 months or 1 year, then the same paper is sent to this different set of reviewers later on, and again we wait for the response. That's why there is a delay.
We can, like, incentivize them.
Yeah, like now, if you see the rejection rate, we didn't talk about the rejection rate. For Springer journals, the rate could be somewhere around 70%. Now we have merged with the Nature. Nature journals are being published through the same company now. Nature has a rejection rate of 90%. Now, in case a publisher is receiving, let's say, 2,000 articles per day, or let's say 20,000 articles per day, it is almost impossible to go through all 20,000 articles in 2 weeks or 3 weeks or 6 months. It takes time. You can't say, okay, we will not accept it. You will, first of all, there are some certain parameters which Lokpal has already told you. And after rejecting certain papers initially, then the rest of the reviewers are being sent to the reviewers, and you have to wait for them. Unless you get all the feedbacks, all the inputs, and then you insert those inputs, whatever corrections are being made into those papers. It's a long process. So sometimes this wait can be 2, 3 years, 4 years also.
One thing is every day, if someone takes a long time and we just take out back paper, then they will get instance in review.
Yeah, this has happened 2 times with me, that I have submitted a paper and it should take a long time. Okay, I'll
say this maybe. Keep inquiring them, they will say that, okay, it's go for a major revision or it's rejected. You just submit in another journal.
In another journal. So, you know, once you become a dual, I think you will also do the same thing.
You're talking of niche subjects. I mean, I can give you an example, a live example of a very well-known doctoral scholar who's doing research on management and Hinduism and something like that, a very, very niche area. And he sent his, and he's been published in highly ranked journals abroad. And he sent his paper to a very highly ranked journal and they took 1 year just to find a goddamn reviewer who could understand his paper. 1 year it took, you know, just to find that gentleman. Who then said, I'll give time and whatever, whatever. And then eventually got an R&R and he got published. So that's...
Does the publication
reject the paper? If there's a lack of reviewer?
Yeah.
No, they look for another reviewer then.
It means you score that 90% of the paper are rejected by the nature.
Ma'am, I would like to ask about the parliament. Can you say that you have to sign that paper? You have to use a legal paper. So,
here we go.
How to check the mechanism, you know, before submitting an article? I used to use 20 softwares. So what is happening? They are checking the plagiarism on the names, means that are the standard definitions and the names that they are using, and that is counted as the plagiarism. So is this caught in the publishing or not? Means 27% of plagiarism just given by the US definitions and names and author names, that is using the plagiarism. So what is this problem?
Should be 0% here. Why do you want any kind of?
No, ma'am.
I'm just saying, as a scholar, why would I want anyone to point a finger that even my one sentence has been plagiarized?
Not sentence. When it's using the words. I mean, suppose I have used a definition.
Using words is also plagiarism. I mean, if you do not, you have to quote it. Now, up to 40 words, if you take somebody's excerpt, you have to put it in. Am I not getting a question?
Let's say the term is fuzzy. A term is fuzzy, okay?
Right. Fuzzy logic.
Yeah, fuzzy logic.
The
right?
Same, always same.
The software will show that this is also plus right. Okay. The fuzzy logic is also. But this is a general term.
We cannot change it.
I mean, we cannot change
that's
it.
That's why there are different levels for plagiarism.
What's the publisher?
Most of the publisher, they have a level of 30. Because it depends on the publisher also. Sometimes it's they rejected 25% and like in Springer, there is an average of 30-35%. That is accepted. Because there is a bibliographic references and all that, it will highlight all of them. But 30-35% of these acceptable norm in publishing industry. But for especially like Nature journals where they have a impact factor of 35, there the plagiarism could be at 25% also. So it depends on the publisher itself. So you don't worry about the 20-25% of that highlights.
I don't know whether
you are
using a plagiarism software
here.
We have our own.
Any other questions? Okay, so I hope you've understood the importance of packaging your paper, how important it is for your paper to fit into a journal, so you need to do a wide journal search. And how important it is to cite properly and get permission so that you're not accused of plagiarism. Ignorance is no excuse. I'll just end with an example of a fellow doctoral scholar who was from the army. So when I was in class with him, he used to sit absolutely proper, straight back, would not move, 3-hour class, and he would not move, this gentleman. And he was so disciplined and very high ethical standards, and it was incredible. He was chatting with me one day and he says, Payal, my professor says I'm going to be flunked, and he says that you plagiarized everything. I nearly fell off my chair. I said, you and plagiarized, how is it possible? You know, you don't even breathe in the class. So, then I realized immediately that what he had done is, probably you've not cited. Huh? What happens is, this was the strategy area, doctor seminar strategy. He had spoken of the extant literature, he spoke of the scholars, you know, somebody's, he took their ideas without giving a proper citation. And obviously the professor knows the extant literature, So he immediately felt that this gentleman has plagiarized. So the professor was saying, I'm going to give you an F, this is unacceptable, blah, blah, blah. So I told him, you write to him and say that this is my mistake. I mean, I was ignorant of the citation process, just let me redo it again. And then he got in and he passed and whatever. So, but ignorance is actually not an excuse. You can't say that I didn't know. You have to cite, be very careful about it. And I'll leave you with one very last example, that how one scholar I know was so obsessed by this, the other extreme. He was so obsessed by citing and proper citing, proper way of doing things. He was actually a professor in America who came back to India and he's teaching at TIS. And he had had a corridor conversation with a doctoral scholar of his, and what the doctoral scholar said actually summarized very well a section that he was writing about. So he said to that doctoral scholar, you go onto YouTube and make these statements so that I can cite you from YouTube. You know? I mean, that's like how some professors take this so, so seriously that, you know, if it's not my idea, I need to cite it. So hopefully we'll all get to that kind of level. Yeah? Thank you so much for your time, and I appreciate a very nice audience.
Thank you very much. Kunj will actually take you through to the product website, what we have. It's called link.springer.com. South Asian University is getting access through Springer journals, and these journals are available in 10 subject collections. So you have access to about 1300 plus journals available in your university. Make use of them. And Kunj will take you through link.springer.com, and he will tell you how to access these journals in a better way so that it can help you in your research. Okay. And then we will proceed for lunch. Lunch is served outside. We have a recommendation form in each kit. I would appreciate if you can just fill up this recommendation form and give it back to us. And please fill up all your details at the bottom, and whatever subject collection you're interested in, just take out.
Thank you, Payan. Thank you, Surbhi. Because we have some time, so I would like to brief you about Springer sites. In fact, we have been talking about only the, how to write a paper. But since you have access to Springer journals, and you are talking to library for the other resources also. So we have two websites. You know, normally any company has a single website called springer.com, something like that. But we have two different websites. One is for users who have access to our contents, and another one is a generalized website. And another is a generalized website which gives you information about Springer as a company, products we offer, pricing of print and online books and all those things. So as a user, when you want to search for any article on Springer journals, you need to go to link.springer.com. This is the website for the users. Link.springer.com. This is the website. If you see this website, all the subjects collections are shown on the left hand side. You have a search box there. And then you have advanced search also. You can go to the, you can click on advanced search button, and then you will see various options, like if you have an or and, nor, or maybe you want to search for a phrase like you search on Google. So those search parameters are already there under our advanced search. So if you see here, these are the subjects. Anybody who goes to this springerlink.com website, you have to just search by your keyword. You can put in your keyword just in the search box, and the moment you search it, click on search button, you will see a lot of information on the left hand side. So if you can just help me out. Just go there and put in a keyword. Anybody from biotech on your computer science can give a keyword to me for searching anybody, any research area. Nanotechnology. So we just type nanotechnology.
STEM technology?
Nanotechnology. And search. Because the moment you search it, it will throw all kinds of material we have. We have articles, we have books, we have chapters. People who are working on life sciences, we have protocols also. So all these items are shown on the left hand side.
Here you can see 23,000, more than 23,000 chapters and 72,000 articles. We have protocols, we have books. So depending upon your requirement, you can click on article or a book or a chapter, whatever you want. Now you can see this is an integrated website which gives you results on all subjects, all kind of products we have. Since we have access only to journals right now, but within the journals we have some open access journals. Like we publish around 4,000 journals as of today. Springer is the largest publisher of journals, and out of them, around 2,000 journals are English language journals, which are paid journals. And the rest of the journals, there are around 600 journals, which are where you are not paying anything for access to those articles. Author have to pay for the publication of those articles. So that is the revenue model for open access. Now, you have access to 1,300 plus journals within this university. There could be some other journals which are not part of this package. Those are open access. You can download articles from those journals also. But even within the paid journals, the journals which are not part of the package but are paid, you cannot access the entire journal. Some of the articles are open access. So what happens? The moment you click here on, just go back. Click on articles. It will display all 72 articles on the screen. Here, if it shows download, that means this article can be downloaded without any hassle. But if you find this kind of a lock, that means you can't read it because this is not part of your package. Because it's a paid article or from a paid journal. But there could be some journals where those are not part of the package, but still articles in open access. Similarly, for the books and chapters, you are not using our Springer books. We have more than 2 lakh books on our website, 200,000 books on different subjects, and you don't have access to those books, but still you can see how many books can be accessed or how many chapters can be accessed. Go back.
So there are about 23,000 chapters available.
Yeah, there are 23. Now there is another technique to see only the subscribed contents, because it's almost impossible to go through all 23,000 chapters or books or whatever. There is a checkbox here. This is called include preview only. Preview means you can only preview these articles or books or chapters. That means these are, you can see the abstracts of these articles and books. You cannot see the entire text. The moment you deselect, you unselect this checkbox, it shows those articles or books or chapters which can be accessed by you. So suppose you just said another technology. I will further, you know, we have a search inside mode where we can say carbon nanotubes within this one. So just go up and within this box type nanotechnology, then add carbon nanotubes.
Carbon
nanotubes. Access to the books and chapters, but still there are 16 chapters and 3 reference works where you can open and download them. I think you have to make the search again because it's still showing the log. Just type carbon nanotubes. So there are total more than 14,000 articles, 4,300 chapters, 219 protocols. But the moment we deselect this checkbox, this number will come down and it will throw up only those articles and chapters which can be downloaded by you. This is how you can use this product or Springer website, because it really confuses you when you see thousands of articles which one to see and which can be downloaded. So the moment you deselect, you can download the required article from this list. Now you can't see, you will see only download PDF. Similarly, when you click on a book or book chapter, In case you click on the book, it will give you the list of the chapters, and either you can download the entire book or you can go by chapters also. Go back. So everything is there on a single platform. You need not to search for books separately, articles separately. It is on a single platform. And now I will take you to the second website, Springer.com, because Pine was talking about the Springer author services. You need to go to those author services and read them thoroughly. I'm not an author, I'm not writing any articles, so I don't go to that website very frequently. But once you just get down to that website, some website, you will see a lot of information. But that is not only useful for Springer publication, it is useful for any other publication also. You can utilize those parameters. We have a tool also where you just put in your keywords. It will tell you which is the most relevant journal available on Springer where you can publish that article. Springer.com. Here you can see services. Then you have author address. Click from there. Then books, authors and editors, general authors, general editors, author academy. Click on author academy. Why is publishing important? So you will find a lot of information there. So what we were trying to say, that when you want to publish something, you have to keep on reading them. More you read, more clear will be concept to you, and then you can further go to any of the publisher, wherever you want to publish it, but basic parameters of publishing will remain same, respective of whether you go to Springer website or any other website. But this is like a tutorial for you, how to write a paper, how to publish, where to publish, and there will be a lot of other sub-sites within it. Like when within the author academy, you have writing your manuscript, submitting and peer review, open access, peer, so lot of information is there. And in case you have any clarification or further, because Payal is not on her role, so she is available only for these author workshops. But any further clarification, you can write directly to us. My email ID is kunj.varma, K-U-N-J, kunj.varma@springer.com. So what will happen, we will like conduct whatever you write to us, we will forward to the concerned editorial team, and they will reply back. Even if you want to write a book for us, anybody of you or any of your faculty or guide, in case they wish to write a book for Springer, we have a full-fledged editorial team in Delhi who are basically they are covering, you know, they are collecting manuscripts from different authors. We have authors here within this university also. In the morning we are talking to them. And you can submit, you can directly interact with the editorial team about the concerned subject. And they will guide you how to go through. We will not give you any help in terms of article publication, because articles are directly submitted on our website, on the same website. Whatever you write, there will be some format kind of, you find a form, you have to submit the initial information about your article, and that will be submitted online, and we can't help you out in even tracing that article. But in case of books, obviously we have an editorial team in Delhi, they can help you. And in case you have any further questions, I think with this we will close this session. Yes, we have to distribute.
We have distributed the recommendation forms.
Oh no, I'm not talking about recommendation. I'm talking about
certificates.
Yes.
Certificates. I think within 2 days you can collect it from the library, because Mr. Madhavan has to sign those certificates.
So,
we are done. Yeah. We just collect the recommendation forms, and if you filled all the details.
One more thing to these journals, though you have access to more than 1300 journals of Springer, but that access starts from 97 onwards. Any article which has been published after 97, that can be accessed. Any article which is published prior to 97, that cannot be accessed on our platform. For that we have journal archives, that's a separate journal altogether. In case you are facing this problem, like you are not able to download a particular article, either this can be either because article was published prior to 1997, or that article is basically from a journal which is paid and which is not part of the package.
the lunch is waiting for you guys outside.